But sometimes I still try to take control. 'Cause I get scared when I can't see the end. And all you want from me is to let go.
Promised. Back on dry ground, thankful like Lazarus, finally unbound. tells the sun to rise every morning, colors the sky with the shades of his glory, wakes us with mercy and love, Jesus does. Who holds the orphan and comforts the widow, cries for injustice and feels every sorrow, carries the pain of his children, Jesus does.
And so we sing
praise to the Father who gave us the Son, and praise to the Spirit who's living in us. When I was a sinner, he saved me from who I was, 'cause that's what Jesus does. Who understands the heart of a sinner, showers his grace over all our mistakes, and washes us clean with his blood, Jesus does. Who sings a song of sweet forgiveness? Who stole the keys to hell and the grave? And who has the power to save? Jesus does. And so we sing praise to the Father who gave us the Son, and praise to the Spirit who's living.
Who gave us the Son, praise to the Spirit who's living in us. When I was a sinner, he saved me from who I was. So we sing praise to the Father
who gave us the Son, and praise to the Spirit who's living in us. When I was a sinner, crying out from the pit of my despair. There you were in the shadows, holding out your hand, you met me there. And now where would I be without you? Where would I be, Jesus? You were the voice in the desert, calling me out in the dead of night, fighting my battles for me. You were my rescue story, lifting me up from the ashes, carried my soul from death to life, bringing me from glory to glory. You were my rescue story. You are my rescue. pages, before I had a name, before I needed grace. Singing songs of redemption, 'cause every time I ran away, you were louder than my shame. And now where would I be without you? Where would I be? Jesus, you were the voice in the desert, calling me out in the dead of night, fighting my battles for me. You were my rescue story, lifting me up from the ashes, and carried my soul from death to life, bringing me from glory to glory. You were my rescue story. You never gave up on me. You never gave up on me. You were my testimony. Oh. Never gave up on me. You never gave up on me. This is my testimony. Oh, you never gave up on me. You never gave up on me. This is my testimony. Oh, you were the voice in the desert, calling
appreciate it. We just take that all for granted. These churches all over this country would love to just have one of those singers in their church this morning. So, and you all are spoiled. You just sit there and relax and enjoy it, don't you? Huh? I got to tell you something. As I was trying to get a message for this week, had a couple different things on my mind and couple different directions I thought I would go. I know we're entering into a new year, and you always want to try to put forth some challenges for the new year and all those kind of things. But I had been in the office last night, had some notes here and there for a couple different things. And when I got up this morning, I got up early. I couldn't sleep, so I got up, and about 5:30, I went in to get my phone in the bathroom. I happened to see my phone. It was sitting there on the charger, and there was something on the screen. I didn't know it was some kind of a message, you know, on the screen to me, so I can't see without these. So I went and got my glasses and stuck them on and seen what was on the screen. And the very thing that was on the screen is what I'm going to try to read to you right now. It was a scripture said, strengthen the things which remain, was a scripture on my phone screen this morning. Now, I'm constantly listening to preaching, looking up scripture, different things on my phone, so that's the kind of stuff pops up on my phone a lot of times is scripture. But when I seen that on the screen this morning, the Lord changed my thought, changed my message for the day. And I know that Doug and Caleb, they know what I'm talking about. You just love it when the Lord does that, about when you got about 2 hours to get ready. But anyway, I'm going to give you what he laid on my heart, okay? Revelation chapter 3, starting with verse 1, said, unto the angel of the church in Sardis write these things, saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Did you get that? Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, listen to this, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. The book of Revelation was written by John, but it's the words of Jesus. If you look in my Bible, all the what I just read you is written in red. You know what that means? That means it's the words of Jesus. And, you know, this really was an answer to a question the disciples had asked Jesus when he was still here. But the problem was Jesus hadn't been to the cross yet. But in this scripture, he had been to the cross. He had been resurrected, and he was looking back on what the question that they had asked, and he had an answer for them at this point. But I wanted us to look at this. John was the last apostle left. All the rest of them was done gone. He was the last apostle left. Have you ever, how many times, you know, have you felt like you're the last one left standing? I mean, honestly, today in the world we live in, a lot of times when you stand for the truth, there's not too many going to rally around you and going to help you out. And I'll tell you what else. If you preach the truth, and I believe that our preachers here try our best to, you're not going to have the crowds bursting out the doors. You know what I'm saying? Because people really don't want the truth today. They'd rather you tickle their ears a little bit and let them go to Bob Evans or wherever and get their sandwich or whatever they're going to have for lunch. A lot of you may already have on your mind what you're going to eat for dinner. I don't know. I hope not. I hope our minds is on the word today. But listen to me. You look around, there's things on these walls that we have some things here that stand for something. Now, people's made fun of us for having baby buggies and whatever else hanging on the wall. So there have been some people made fun of us for those kind of things. And I tell you what, he said, let's strengthen the things that remain. You look around here and there's evidence of God's power. There's evidence of God's glory hanging on these walls right here. And I'm going to tell you, it didn't just happen by accident. Some of the very ones that's made fun are some of the ones who've called us when they got in need and wanted prayer. You know who they called? They called the people with the stuff hanging on the walls. I don't want us to get caught up today in the things of this world. And we are a lot of times. We do get caught up in it. We're always looking for the next thing, or we want to be like the church maybe down the road, or you may want to, you know, some of them have stuff for their, there's nothing wrong with having things for the kids. And we do here. We have activities for the kids and they do things with them, and there's not a thing wrong with that. But if that's all that it amounts to, that you have a party sometime or get them a pizza or a cookie or whatever and let them play ball, then you're missing the whole thing this morning, what it's all about. So I want us to look around here on these walls and look at what God has done for us. And I want us to think, we are a remnant left in this world today. Churches like Beach Fork is a remnant that's left in this world today, because there's not too many people who want the kind of services that we have. They really don't want people standing on their feet, people shouting, waving their hands. There's a lot of churches really don't want that. They just like to come and keep things kind of peaceful. You say, well, maybe there's no sense in that. I'm going to tell you something. We're the remnant, and we got to stand today in our integrity to Jesus Christ. And if you want him to keep coming, you want the Holy Spirit to keep visiting, you want miracles to keep happening, we better strengthen the things that remain. And those things just don't happen by accident. The generation that came before me, I'm talking about Bonnie and Freddie's generation, my dad's generation, Lowell May's generation. That generation right there before us were a little bit different than my generation. Now you all just sit tight just a minute and let me give you what the Lord laid on my heart. That generation right there, church wasn't just something that they did on Sunday morning. It wasn't just something they showed up for the service because it was scheduled at 10 o'clock on Sunday morning, Doug, and then you didn't see them again till next Sunday. And if you did see them out in the world during that week, you know what most of the time they were talking about? They were talking about the Lord. They had their mind on the Lord. Now, I'm going to tell you, you talk to James Ray, anytime people come in the sawmill when James Ray was living, I'll guarantee you they heard about the Lord. He would ask them, do you go to church anywhere? Are you saved? He didn't care. He just would come out and ask them because that's what was on his mind. But today we've got everything else on our mind. We're going after everything else instead of the number one thing like he was doing and what he talked about. Religion was more than just attending church. It was their life. Some of you looking at me awful strange. Do you believe what I'm telling you is the truth? Now I realize we got to go to work and make a living. We got to feed our families. We got to pay our bills. We got to do all those things. I understand that. That's not what I'm talking about. Matthew 6:33, one of my favorite scriptures, says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and these things. And if you look at what these things were, it was all those things that you need to survive. It was food, it was shelter, it was their clothing, all the things that the Gentiles worried about, is what he said. God knows you got need of all those things, but if we seek him first, we put him first, he'll make sure that our needs are supplied. I believe that today. Does anybody here believe that besides me? All right, I wondered if I was in the wrong church for a little bit. God was number one. Living for him, worshiping him. That was their number one priority, the generation before us. Their businesses, everything else took second place. I can remember on Wednesday night, Doug, we'd have hay mowed. Now, some of you still farm, and we used to farm quite a bit. And on Wednesday, my dad would have hay mowed, and there'd be a rain coming that night. And you know what we done when it come church time? We shut the tractor off, went and got ready for church, and if the hay got wet, it got wet, Freddie. But God always took care of the need. Second cutting might have been the best one that year if you put God first. I'm just telling you, that's how it was. Now, if we come home tonight or today, the day we're living in, we come home from work on Wednesday and we're a little bit tired, we just kick our feet back and say, well, you know, I'm tired. I'm going to stay home. I need to rest tonight. I don't believe I'll go to the house of the Lord tonight. Now, I'm going to be the first one to tell you, that kind of rubs your pastor the wrong way. I'm just going to tell you that. Now, I understand people have other things. I understand you're tired. I understand kids have got things going on. But I'm going to tell you this. I don't care. I've made this statement. I don't care if you come in your scrubs. I don't care if you come in your ball uniform. I don't care if you come in your work clothes. If you got a desire to be in the house of God on Wednesday night, and you come in from work like that, you come on to the house of God. We'll let you come right on in, sit down with the rest of us, and worship with us. But I'm going to tell you, we're so busy trying to fit in to today's culture. Listen to me. The church world today has got caught up in trying to fit in with this world's culture. Now, we may live in this world, but the Bible teaches us we're not of this world. We're part of a different kingdom today. I may be living in America, and if there's a patriot here, it's me. I mean, I get choked up sometimes when they play the Star Spangled Banner and they're waving the flags because I believe we live in the greatest country in the world. God gave us this opportunity to live here, and there's a lot of people died to give us the freedoms we got. But I'm going to tell you something. I got a dual citizenship. I may be part of the United States of America, but I am also part of that heavenly kingdom. And that's the one I'm working and striving to make it to today. We're so busy, trying to fit in. And I know that we got to have the greatest and the latest and greatest. We go out and buy these kids these $200 and $300 shoes. I wore old Converse Chucks when I was playing ball, and there wasn't a whole lot really between you and the floor, really, to be honest with you. And we made it just fine. But today we got to fit in, and we work overtime and extra hours to try to buy the things that we really don't need to impress people we really don't like, and then we wonder why we ain't got time to fit God into our lives. Buy $400 softball bats. That's the craziest thing I ever seen. I was at Dick's Sporting Goods, and I started looking at baseball bats and softball bats. $375, $475 for a ball bat. And I'm thinking, you know, we played with a stick sometimes out in the barnyard when I was a kid. You know, we'd tape up something and make a ball out of it, and that was our wiffle ball and bat. We made it just fine, Everett. But now we got to have all this stuff, and we're pushing God clear out. I thank God we still have a remnant. At Beach Fork Church, we got a remnant who's still holding on to some of the old-fashioned things, still holding on to some of the old-fashioned beliefs that believe you got to go the knee route way. If you're going to make it into the kingdom of God, you're going to have to fall on your knees somewhere and repent of your sins. Now, I don't think you have to come and talk to the priest or to the preacher. You don't have to tell me everything you've done, but you're going to have to repent to him and ask him to cover your sins with his blood. And when you accept him as your Savior, that's exactly what he'll do. And we've got a remnant here that still believes that today. I believe that. I want to be part of that remnant. I want to be part of the one who knows who I am in Jesus Christ today. This old boy right here, I'm not fit to go to Otway, let alone to heaven. But through the blood of Jesus Christ, through who I am in him today, the change that he made in my life, Doug, and because I accepted him, I am a fit subject for the kingdom of heaven. And I still believe in that way today. We got to stand up. We got some people willing to stand up for what's right. Verse 4 here said, thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments. In other words, they're still holding on. They're still seeking out the old paths. Not too many people in America today are still seeking out the old paths, Freddie, and walking therein. But they're seeking out every other way that they can find. If they can find some out of the avenue that they think they can make it to heaven, they're going to bite on that. And then you got people like Oprah and some of them on TV telling you, oh, there's many ways to heaven. I'm sorry, but that's not what the Word of God teaches. It's not what the Word of God teaches. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And I believe that today. There's still some people holding on to that. Hey, some people aren't jumping on Facebook and trashing their neighbors either, or trashing everything else going up and down the road, trashing their pastor, trashing their church. I mean, we're living in a society today, if somebody goes to the restaurant and their beans ain't cooked just right, they get on Facebook and they just totally trash the place. The waitress was terrible. She didn't bring my stuff on time, or my food was cold when I got it. And then there'll be about a dozen others jump on board and get on there and trash them with it. I'm going to tell you something. The people I'm talking about, the remnant I'm talking about, you know what we do when I order a salad and it's got onions on it and I can't stand onions? They bring a salad out, I just pitch the onions off and eat what I can. Eat around it. I don't have a fit on them because that's not how I was taught. That's not how I was raised here in this church. We got a standard, we got a name. Believe me, when you get out there, you got a name to live up to. And it ain't acting ugly like that, I can tell you. It's not what we've been taught here. We're trying to fit into this day's culture. My folks, I'm going to tell you something. What we need to be doing is lifting one another up in prayer and in love. And in deeds, when you can do a good deed. You know, whenever you see a neighbor in need and you think they need $5 and you got $5, you don't need to pray about it. Just get that money out your old tight wad and help them. God will bless you for it. We don't have to have a committee meeting for that. My focus in 24 is not on those that have left. There have been some people left here. And they're in need now, Freddie. But I'm going to tell you something. The devil would like to get me and Tyson focused on who ain't here. I can talk about Tyson. He's my buddy. We do worry when people don't come. We worry when people don't show up. But I'm going to tell you what. The Lord has laid on my heart, Doug, that we need to focus on the ones that I'm going to focus on, the remnant that's still here with me this morning. The ones of you that are still sitting here in this congregation, you're the ones I can help. I can't help the ones that go the other direction. Nothing I can do to help them. We can pray for them, and that's all we can do for them. But I'm going to tell you, you may be wore out this morning. You may be tired. I tell you something. It's tough sometimes to keep fighting when we're living in a land that is on a downward spiral. Morally, spiritually, you're living in a country today that's on a downward spiral. And when you go against that grain all week long, and you're out there and you feel like you're the only one still standing for what's right, and you're the only one that has morals and want to operate your business in your life in a moral way like God told us to do in His Word, you get wore down. Some of you may be praying for God to do something in your life. It may be physical, it may be spiritual, it may be emotional, it may be a physical need. I don't know what you're trusting God, what you've been praying for. And the enemy likes to get us, sometimes we'll get tired. We do get wore down. We get beat down whenever we fight that and we pray and we don't see anything happening. And I know I preached a message on water on the sacrifice, and sometimes that is what's going on, but it's still, we get tired. But I'm going to tell you this. I'm going to focus on sticking with those who stand by the stuff and strengthen what remains. I'm going to tell you, they were certainly not perfect in Sardis. He said, as a matter of fact, strengthen the things that remain that are ready to die. I mean, they were in pretty bad shape. They were in need. But he told them, don't quit. Don't give up. But strengthen the things that remain that are about to die. Don't let them die this morning. But let's strengthen those things. Bless God, I'm going to tell you something. We're not dead yet. We may be tired. We may be beat down sometime, but we're not dead yet. We're still serving a living God this morning that has got your best interest at heart. And buddy, I'm not giving up on Him. I'm going to keep on fighting the battle. I'm going to keep strengthening the things that I know that are written in this Word, the things that remain that we've held sacred here all of my lifetime. I want to hold on to those things this morning. We're not dead yet. I don't want to become so fixated or so focused on what's next. Listen to me. The enemy, he tries to get our minds sometimes so fixed and so focused on what's going to happen tomorrow. You know, yeah, but you don't know what I'm facing. I'm facing this tomorrow, or I'm facing this next week, or I got this bill that's coming due, and you don't know what I'm facing. And the enemy will get us fixated on that ever that we forget to live in today. We forget about what we have today. I don't need money to pay my bill that's due next week yet. But you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to thank God that I had the money to pay the bills that was due this week. That's already happened. He already gave me the money to pay the bills that were due. But the enemy would like to get you to focus so much on what's out there, what could go wrong, what could happen. My job may, you know, I'm going to tell you something. Right now, I don't have a job too far ahead. I've got one job left to do, and I'm done. And it's always been that way in my business. I have to pray and trust God. And so far, Doug, He sent us in something. Every time I got to the place I thought I was done, the devil, he likes to tell me, you shouldn't say stuff like this. I'm just going to go ahead and say it because it's the truth. I'm 62 years old. I started working for myself when I was 25. Every job that I've ever got, God gave me. He had to send them my way. I didn't do anything ever really to earn them or to get them, but God sent them my way. And in that length of time, I only remember being out of timber one day. And that was really because we didn't have all the paperwork done to get a move in. But God has always furnished me a job. My wife has got two jobs that I know of. I know this last job she got, she never interviewed for. They called her on the phone and hired her over the phone. She never even went in for an interview. And really, the people didn't know her. But can I tell you what they did know? She had a reputation. They knew her reputation. That's what I'm trying to get across this morning. We've got a reputation. And let's strengthen those things that remain, the things that we've held on to. I don't want to become fixated on tomorrow. I forget about what's going on today and I miss what I have now. Strengthen what remains now. Let me give you an example. The prodigal son, I want to throw this out there. You know, the father becomes so fixated, and you would, on the son that left, on the prodigal. He became fixated on the prodigal. He forgot about the son that was there with him every day. The son that was faithful, the one that was still there taking care of him and taking care of his flocks or whatever else he had that he took care of. The father becomes so fixated on the one that was the prodigal. And that happens in our lives a lot of time. We got a wayward child and we spend all of our time worrying about the wayward child instead of really appreciating the one that's been here and stuck with us. And I don't want to do that at Beach Fork this morning. I want to focus on the one that stayed here faithful. The one, now don't get me wrong, we're still going after the prodigal. We're still praying for him. We'll still reach out to him. We'll do everything we can to see them saved. But I want you to know this. I'm going to focus on the ones that's staying here by the stuff and helping us fight the battle today. And focus on them today. The ones that's remained and got things done. The ones that are faithful. There's 540 scriptures in the Bible that refer to the remnant and to the promise that's been given to the remnant, to the faithful ones. He said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask what you will. That's a promise that he gave us. The ones staying by the stuff. He told us to bring in all your tithes and offering. Bring in all your tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. And prove me now, herewith saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open to you the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing, that you shall not be able to, enough room to contain it or to receive it. Be faithful in a few things, and I'll make you ruler over many. I mean, I can give you scripture after scripture in the Word of God where there's promises that's given to the ones that stay by the stuff, the ones that are the remnant, the ones that'll stay faithful, the ones that'll strengthen the things that remain. Be faithful in a few things. Well, what's got us here where we're at? What things are we talking about strengthening? What has got the results you see hanging on the walls? What's kept some of these dear old saints of God for 50 and 60 and 70 years? I'm going to tell you, it's the same old things. Burnett taught on it this morning in class a little bit. You got to pray. You want something from God, you need to ask him. Then you got to believe for it. You know, I'm going to tell you, I was raised by parents that they loved their kids. They'd do anything. I believe they would have done anything they could to help me. If my dad knew I was in need and I'd say, Dad, I need this or that, he would have done everything he could to help me. The Father we serve is a good God. And I'm going to tell you, he won't withhold any good thing if you're praying and not praying amiss. He said, why didn't everybody heal? You know, nobody'd ever die, would they? If he healed everybody, nobody'd ever die. I have no answers for why Certain people get healing, certain people don't. We were praying for Cheryl's son, Justin, this morning. The boy should have never lived through what he lived through. But God brought him through that. And why did he? He's got a reason for it, Everett. There's a reason why he spared that boy and why he's still with us. I believe that with all my heart. And I'm going to trust him this morning. What got us here? Praying. Reading the Word of God. Believing the Word of God. Trusting the Word of God. Teaching the Word of God. Preaching the Word of God. That's what got us to the place we're at today. And you know what the other thing? The three things we preach and teach all the time. Praying, reading your Bible, and coming to church. You say, well, I can watch it online. You cannot get the experience. You can't experience the Holy Spirit online like you can. Now, I'm not saying you won't. I felt the Holy Spirit. I can listen to a song on the radio driving down the road in my truck and experience the Holy Spirit in my life. But I'm telling you this, it ain't the same as being here in the house of God with a group of believers, with the remnant that still believes in the good things that we believe in. It's not the same this morning as being here in the house of God. Let's hold on to the things. Let's hold on to the things that, and strengthen those things. Let's be the remnant. You want to do that? You're going to help me with that this morning? Let's stand to our feet. I don't know who this message is for. Maybe it's just for me. But I doubt that. But maybe it was. But I plan on strengthening the things that I know, Everett, are the right things and holding on to them this morning. Let's don't be weary and well done, because the Bible says we'll reap in due season if we faint not. I'm not going to become weary in the things of God, in praying and holding these ones up for prayer. I'm telling you, we serve a big God today. Maybe you've been fixated on the future or on things you're going to do out there, or things that are worrying you for tomorrow. There's nothing wrong with wanting to have a nice home and a nice vehicle and all that kind of stuff. And people are working toward those things, and I know that's the American dream. And I'm not up here throwing water on your dreams. But I'm here to tell you this. You get on the other end of this thing looking back. Some of us are getting there. And the things that I thought that I had to work for, the things I thought I needed, the things I thought I wanted to do, really didn't amount to a whole lot, Jeff. But having your health and having your family, those are the things that are important. Seeing them in the house of God. Seeing them, I know my grandkids, you want to see them do great things, and they are doing great. They're doing good in school and making good grades. And I know Brock, he'd like to play for Ohio State. Well, I'd like to see that. But you know what? I'd rather he be a bench warmer and come to the house of God and serve God and put God first in his life. I don't care if he ever plays another ball game. I mean, I enjoy watching him, and I'm thankful for all that. But I know what the most important thing is. Is there anybody here this morning that agrees with anything I've preached to you? If you're struggling this morning with something, we're going to give you another chance. There have been people already prayed, and we're thankful for the ones that stepped out. I always say the time to pray is when you feel like it. We don't have no schedule on that. Preacher ain't got a monopoly on the altar call. Whenever the Spirit speaks to you and you need to pray, you step out and you come to this altar. I don't care if we're singing or what we're doing. Somebody will come and pray with you. But if you didn't miss your opportunity, we're giving you one right now. Would you step out, come and pray this morning? Has God spoke to anybody? You need prayer? Man, this is golden opportunity. We love y'all. appreciate your attention this morning. I want you to come back tonight. Brother Caleb's preaching tonight. 7 o'clock, the service. We got to do some switching around on singers, I believe. We got some sick, but we'll have singers. Don't worry about that. It'll all be good. Come back tonight and worship with us. We love you all. God bless you.